Welcome everyone to the Inside Java Newscast episode 13, where we cover recent developments in the Java community. My name is Jose. I know you must be very disappointed not to see Nikolai, but don't worry, he will be back very soon. Well, knowing where he is, I just hope that we will see him back in one piece and with his own blood. Today, I have four topics for you. First, in case you've been living in a coffin for the last 4 weeks, Java 17 has been released. You can follow the links down below to grab it. And with it, the presentation of the last developer live are now available on YouTube. Because Java 17 has been published, we are now on our way to Java 18. The first early access builds are available. And there are two things I would like to highlight. First, the fact that the default car set starting with the JDK 18 will be UTF-8. And second, well, simply the list of the JEPs we currently have and what we can expect. And the last topic is the dev.java website. This is our new site for every information and documentation you need on the language itself and its APIs. Java Developer Live was held online on September 16th, and the replays are now available on the Java YouTube channel. Links are in the description down below. You can follow the keynote with Shara Chander, George Saab, Aurelio Garcia Ribeiro, Manish Gupta and Chad Arimura, and the experts panel with Bernard Traversa, Chad Arimura, Michael Wittstedt and Shara Chander. I would like also to mention several talks. You can learn about SEAL classes with Venkat Subramaniam. SEAL classes are a feature of the JDK 17, and Venkat is the most amazing speaker on the planet, so you really want to check this one. Nikolai, that usually is doing this newscast, also talked about pattern matching, both features and preview features of the JDK 17. You can learn about the upcoming Vector API and Incubator feature of the JDK 17 with Paul Sandoz. By the way, if you are not sure about the difference between a standard feature, a preview feature, and Incubator feature, or if you do not know how to use them or how to activate them if you want to test them, there is a page that tells you all about it on the dev.java website. As usual, link in the description down below. If you want to understand how floating point arithmetic is working, you can also watch the excellent presentation by Joe Darcy. Floating point arithmetic is not really a new topic, but you will probably still learn something in it. The way he explained this subject is very clear and very educational. I would like also to recommend the Java Language Futures edition Fall 2021 by Gavin Bierman, where he covers what is about to be delivered by the project Amber, that is mostly pattern matching, and would like also to mention the excellent talk by Mala Gupta, Learn Java 17 with IntelliJ IDEA. If you want to learn more about Project Amber or give feedback, as usual, follow the links in the description down below. There are two topics that the internet has tried very hard to solve, car sets and time zones. Time zones, that will be for another time. But car set, I can tell you that having an acute accent in your first name gives you an idea of how non-ASCII characters are handled on the internet. And I can tell you that there is still some work to be done. So, what is the problem in Java? Take the InputStreamReader class, for instance. This class reads binary files that contains characters encoded with any char set. When it opens such a file, it chooses the default char sets of the underlying operating system, unless you provide one char set explicitly. So the decoding of the file depends in fact on the operating system and on how it has been configured. The same file decoded on a Linux machine configured with an UTF-8 default encoding will look different than decoded on a Windows machine configured with the default CP1252 char set. Even on the same machine, changing the default char set at the operating system level may make your application behave differently. Of course, this is not really acceptable for Java application. And this may lead to wrong behavior for your Java application. So far, the JDK 18 already integrates the JEP 400 called UTF-8 by default. What this JEP specified is that UTF-8 is the default car set of the standard Java APIs. With this change, APIs that depend upon the default car set will behave consistently across all implementations, operating systems, locales, and configurations. But it may cause problems if you are running your application on a different default car set. Especially if you are running your app on a Windows machine, you should try this feature. By the way, there is a very interesting article to read about this, link down below. The good news is, you can try it right now. If you feel like an explorer, you can download the early access builds of the JDK 18, links to that down below, and provide feedback as usual. But if your application is using the JDK 8, for instance, you can also add a special command line option, which is -d file.encoding, that's a property, equals utf-8, that's the value of the property. And it will have the exact same effect. So even if you're using the JDK 8, you can see what it gives and act accordingly. The JDK 18 is bound to be released in March 2022. We should have another preview of pattern matching for Switch, which is already a preview feature in the JDK 17. We should also have a preview of record pattern matching with record deconstruction and array pattern matching. These two features are covered in the JEP 405, record patterns and array patterns. This is still a preview JEP and still a candidate to be integrated in the JDK 18. So things may change before the integration. Some JEPs are already targeted to the JDK 18. The JEP 400 UTF-8 by default is the first, we just talked about this one. We should have a third incubator version of the Vector API delivered by the project Valhalla, which is great. And the same goes for the JEP 413 code snippets in Java API documentation. The Java API documentation is commonly referred to as the JavaDoc. It's a great feature that you can check out. By the way, I will record a JEP Cafe about it, so stay tuned for more. Last thing I wanted to talk to you about is that the dev.java website is open for business. In fact, we launched it at the same time as the JDK 17. What can you find on this website? It's basically a bunch of tutorials on the language itself, on the APIs of the JDK, and all the tools you have in a JDK. You will find all the download links that you need to download Java on your machine and tutorials on how to install it. If you're a complete beginner, this tutorial will show you step by step how to run your first Java application on your machine. And because we are old geeks, yes, this is a Hello World application. There is a tutorial on how to use JShell or JLink. If you are a seasoned Java programmer, you may learn how to use preview or incubator features, in case you don't already know that. There is already a lot of content on this website, with much more to come, because it is still a work in progress. And even if you are a seasoned Java programmer, you should check it out. Every feature is presented along with patterns and advanced examples, so you may discover things that you didn't know. Stay tuned for more. The next big thing that is still being tested is the possibility to run snippets of Java code directly from within the browser, without having to launch your IDE. We call this feature the Java Playground. I can tell you that it already looks great and works, but it's not quite ready for prime time. There are still rough edges that need some polishing. So, just as before, stay tuned for more. And with this, I'm out of news, so that's it for today. Talk to you soon.